All right. Hi, everybody. Thanks, Doug. Hi, everybody. Welcome to the What's New with Goodman Games seminar at North Texas RPG 2015. So you guys, we do these seminars at different cons to talk about what we're working on. So part of this is just what we're working on, in progress stuff. Part of it will be some announcements. And then part of it is we have a special guest, Bob Bledsaw Jr. We'll talk about some awesome, yeah, let's get Bob. Yeah, awesome. And we're working on a lot of stuff for Judges Guild, and he's going to talk through. We just had breakfast, and he was telling us really cool stories of back in the day. So half of this is talking about the work, and half of this is just showing off cool stuff. Bob, you want to jump right in and talk about some of the stuff we're working on?
Joe's doing some really wonderful work with restoring and archiving our original product line. You can see the difference. This is the way a really good conditioned...
the Judges Guild Journal.
Yeah, the journal newsletter. I mean, they're falling apart today. If you can find them, they're on newsprint, and they're very expensive, hard to find. But you can see the scan is really high quality. Citadel of Fire, which Michael Curtis will be expanding on and doing for us.
And let me come up there. Let me show, point out some details, you guys. So a lot of this stuff, you know, part of the goal here is to restore the legacy of Judges Guild and produce a product that's not falling apart, because all the stuff we own is 40 years old and falling apart from wear and tear and use. And this is the original cover. And from far away, you may not be able to see the difference, but feel free to come up afterwards. And this is the restored cover, which is scanned from the original, digitally restored. So the colors are a lot brighter. There's a bleed added, and it sort of lets you see the original as it appeared back in the 70s before it got all worn and torn and so on.
And you can see here with our newsletter the difference in the cleanness and the quality and the detail.
Yeah, in the journal, you probably know this, but the original Judges Guild model was subscription-based. So you essentially got something in the mail, and it would always come with a module or an item of some kind and the journal. So the journals were, they're just really hard to find. But the quality here, from not only being originally printed on newsprint and bleeding in the newsprint, and being 40 years old, but we picked this image that has Chewbacca because back in that era, Star Wars was new and exciting, and they would show the shots, the promo shots from Star Wars. But look at how blurry it was in the original publication, and then how crisp it is in the reprint. It frankly, this might look better than some of the originals.
Yes.
It might be the first chance to really see how they were meant to look.
The real detail, yes.
Yeah.
And here is a dungeon level map from Citadel. It shows that even in our original, there, from print to print, there would be bleed and there would be misalignments with the color steps, and that is all being cleaned up. This is the way it was intended to look. Very clean.
And then this one. So each printing, and these Judges Guild books sold tens of thousands of copies, and many went through multiple printings. And the company would alter the cover each time. So that the sometimes they're very similar, like Citadel of Fire, the first two printings were similar before they got really different. Other times, like Batabascor, they're almost completely different covers.
See, at the time, this was actually my first cover. I was an artist. I was just a kid. I was 14 years old. And this was the first cover that my father let me do. And I was always proud of this. Of course, he did the lettering here himself, but I did the color set and I did the design, the logo. You might see a little REBJ there, which Dad would have me sign my artwork by. But as it progressed and it went through different printing processes, not only did the product change itself in content, but the artwork did as well. By the third edition, they had actually added in a change to the castle itself. So my signature was taken off. Dad had made some minor changes to the terrain. The sun is there, the sun is faintly there. The sun is a little bit relocated and it's much larger there. But as time progressed, the products would actually change. They weren't reprints of the same thing. We would expand, we would change interior art, and Joe is capturing all that for us.
And so let me show off the giant volume where we will capture all this. So some of you guys have seen this sample before. So the idea is that we've printed preliminary progress versions of Citadel of Fire and Teagle Banner. You can pick these up at the booth. And part of this is to have a play copy that you can use at your gaming table, right? It's handy, it's small, it's easily usable. But the ultimate goal is this. So you guys are welcome to come pick this up afterwards. It weighs about 10 pounds. And the goal is to have a true archival...
Full size.
Yeah. So I have hidden in here a copy of the Judges Guild Journal. So you can see that the pages are big enough to actually hold an entire page of the journal. And as Bob mentioned, the content would change along each printing, sometimes small ways, sometimes big ways. So we've scanned every printing of Citadel, of Teagle, and Bat of Askor. We're going through the restoration process. That's almost done. And the idea is this will have, you know, the basic content, and then every time it changes or there's an addition or something like that.
Actually, that's what's so great about this. It archives literally every addition and every change.
It's pretty cool.
Question.
Yes.
I just noticed that, you know, a lot of the covers have approved for use by Dungeons and Dragons and stuff like that. Was there a need to go back again for this project and get anybody's permission besides Judges Guild?
Well, we've done a couple things. If you look at the versions that we're selling at the booth, actually, you can see here that legal text is removed from the cover.
Okay.
Of course, later on you can go look at the original scan, you'll see it's slightly different. So we're not, obviously it's not, the license expired a couple years ago.
Yeah.
For purposes of what we produce, you know, inside the book, that's more of a journalistic quality, it's right. Fine to produce that. For the covers and stuff like that, we can't claim it's authorized, so it's not. So you'll see minor changes on the covers, but the interior content will show as originally published. Yeah. If you don't mind, please for a sec, let me show you guys some of the stuff we're doing in terms of apparel. So you guys probably know that if you read the old journals, the Judges Guild Journal would actually advertise this windbreaker.
Yes.
In like the 70s version. So we found a company that could make a very similar windbreaker.
In the same style, in the 70s.
And Bob, tell what you were telling me earlier about what's in your closet.
I've got a couple of the original windbreakers. One belonged to my grandfather, of course, and then one belonged to my father. They're both very worn, but they're very, very hard to find. In fact, they're the only two that I've seen for the past 15, 20 years. So I hope you show that tan t-shirt.
Yeah.
Because that looks very, very authentic. I saw that for the first time
this one
yesterday, and it was like I had stepped out of a time machine into 1978. That's exactly the way they looked in 78. The colors are just spot on.
And the guy who does the graphic design for these is a diehard fan, so he spent a lot of time trying to get it right.
Yes.
Tell him what you were telling me about that. So you guys may not realize this. This is apparently Teddy Roosevelt. Riding the Pegasus, which I did not realize.
When the guild began, my dad had an idea for a logo. It was a shield for a player character that he ran himself in his own campaign. It showed, in fact, the early Dungeoneer journals, or the early journals, had the shield with a dragon's wing with an arrow in it. That was my dad's player character, and it was his first idea for a company logo. But he wanted something more. And I was sitting at the kitchen table one night, and I was flipping through my junior high school yearbook. I went to Teddy Roosevelt Junior High. I was 13 years old. And trying to be an artist. And he says, could you draw us up a logo? And I said, well, what would you like? And he said, well, just come up with something. And I had this little yearbook in my hand, and it had Teddy Roosevelt on the front of it. As I said, Teddy Roosevelt, Rough Rider, with his sword upheld, riding a steed. And my dad said, well, something like this. Can't you make that fantasy? Put wings on that horse. I said, okay, I can do that. So I spent the next maybe a day and a half drawing a really detailed pencil drawing. And you can see from the way it turned out, it was detailed. But it was in pencil. So when my dad took it to the local print shop to have it put on our letterhead and stationery and everything, it was in pencil. And the printer gave him some trouble about it, said, well, this isn't going to come out. This has got a lot of detail, but it's not going to come out with what we have here. And so my dad says, well, it's not ink. So he whipped out a double-aught ink pen, a mechanical pen, and he went over it very quickly in the shop, in the print shop. He sat down at a table or the counter, and he went over it. And he was in such a hurry that, this is the secret, he failed to put the fingers on the front of the hand. So what you have is an overlord with a left hand on his right arm holding the sword up. And so from then on, when my dad brought it back home, he said, there it is, look, it's wonderful. Brought me a big print of it. And I immediately spotted that. I said, Dad, you messed it up. He said, what? I said, you got his left hand on his right arm. And he says, We'll call it the Flying Turkey. And so in-house in the guild, we always refer to it as the Flying Turkey. And so to me, that's what it's always been.
I've heard of two left feet, but never two left arms.
only one was good enough. But I love the logo, but that's the story behind it.
That's hilarious. Yeah. So we printed up a couple other shirts too, and these are based on, if you guys notice, Bob has an awesome Judges Guild polo shirt on.
Yes.
He's way classier than the rest of us. So we printed up a polo. And then of course, this one, which is, you can't see now, but inspired by one of the Bad Ambassador covers. And then lastly, this guy. So pick them up if you can, they're pretty cool. And it's all part of this project. And let me tell you one more exciting thing, which is that Mr. Michael Curtis here has the chance to play in this playground.
Oh, and I'm so happy to do this. I get to go back to the original material and get the opportunity, since we're doing this for the conventions, is I get to play with stuff which has not been played with for far too long. So I wanted to do stuff which was an homage and was kind of done in the same style of what Bob's dad was putting out and what Bill Owen was putting out back in the day. So I wanted to elaborate on like the original Teagle Manor and the original Citadel of Fire. The great thing about these adventures back in the old days is that they weren't, you didn't have, NPCs with like eight, paragraphs of background information about, why the innkeeper runs his inn and, and all the rest of that stuff, because they were just, they were lucky if they had a name and that was it. So there was a lot of room for creativity that, the judges, the whole plan was that a judge could drop this into his campaign, with very little alterations or any really little work, but expand on it. So I had a lot of fun, basically, it's almost like a historical study. I get, start reading through the adventure and finding out, like, what little bit of kernel, like, what's a hint of something more that I could build on. So with Teagle Manor, I got to do an entire little sub-dungeon, not part of the manor itself, but there's a mention about this temple just outside of the village. And that's just very vaguely, some details are mentioned about that in the Wandering Monster encounter, and about how there's like this cult there. So I got to springboard on that, taking the big pieces that were originally laid down there, and have this whole little, little side adventure that you can go and explore, before you go to the manor itself, or, as a break. So that was a lot of fun. And then Citadel Fire, at one point you go into, there's a laboratory and an alchemist workshop. So knowing players, like, okay, well, what's in this bin? All right, what's on this shelf? What's over here and there? So I got to do a 100, a percentile table just full of random junk. Kind of like Dungeon Alphabet stuff. Like, what do you have? Kryptonite, okay. it was really done in the old school, 1977 style, where, okay, there's kind of a blurring between reality and fiction and stuff. And I actually got to play with, there's some acolytes to the wizard there, and so you can kind of cut some deals with them and talk to them. So I got to expand on them a little bit. So it gives you a little bit more than like, let's just go into the Citadel and pillage it. Kind of gives you a reason to maybe, why you're going to go down there trying to rob the vault on the fifth level of the dungeon, or try to assassinate something like that. So it was a lot of fun. I tried to do it in the style, try to make it as terse as possible, but expectations are a little different this day, so it's a little bit bigger. But it's so much fun to do. I did get a chance just to play in that playground. It's absolutely wonderful, and I'm thankful to both Bob and to Joseph for allowing me to do that, and for John Hirschberger, yeah, who had gone to great lengths to reproduce the table of contents in the original style and stuff, and John is very proud and deservedly so.
So John Hirschberger, and you guys probably know Taco John, he's helping out at the booth, he edited the material that Mike did.
Yep.
And we had a number of debates there, because Mike was truly trying to emulate the 70s style, and John was sort of editing it towards modern standards.
He didn't know that when he got the manuscript. So they're like, deliberate, not quite typos, but there's like formatting, like the stat format might be different from one monster to another one, because, yeah, it's almost as if I'm typing up on a selector, and he's like, oh, you gotta change this or anything. Like he says goblins, there's no number of how many goblins you're supposed to be. So he went through and he changed it, he's like, you have to do this. So he must have thought like Mike's been drinking or something. He's like, Mike's obviously slipping here, I don't know what's going on. I was like, no, oh, I was like, oh, sorry, John, you didn't know. All right, that's all intentional. I said, oh, okay. I wish you had told me that before I spent, 3 hours going over your manuscript with my red pen trying to correct all your mistakes. So.
But it turned out great. So if you guys pick this up, the interior is scanned from the original Citadel of Fire. So for those of you who have a 40-year-old copy, you can now have a play copy and keep your other one pristine. And then,
what printing did you guys pull this from?
So that's a great question. This cover is the fourth. This cover is the first. This is, I believe, the second. If you go into the back, you'll see we reprinted. It changes names.
Booty list.
The list of products from the from the Judges Guild, which is a way of sort of dating each printing. All four printings of that list are reproduced. So you have the booty list from the first. It then changed to just a product list. Then it became the Treasure Vault. And then it became more fine products from Judges Guild.
So everything is there from every printing.
Yeah. And eventually, the hardcover, this will literally have, like, we've literally scanned it all. And then we're going through to figure out which portion. I mean, we don't want to reprint the exact same thing. So if 28 of the pages are the same, we'll reprint 28 from, say, the first printing, then reprint the ones that changed or stuff like that. So this is a shorter version, but it has the complete contents from, I think it was, I don't remember actually where most of the content came from, but one of the printings. But then it has in it elements of all printings to form this. And then Mike's stuff is at the back.
Rightfully so. No, I'm serious.
But the supplemental material with new art at the back and so on. It's pretty cool. There's another cover, which I think was it the third printing? The fourth printing that had the ghostly guy, the bluish ghostly.
That would have been the fourth, I believe. Fourth,
yes. So we have a scan of that one, but obviously didn't put it on here. But it'll be in the main hardcover.
And this has a reproduction of these are the fold-out maps in it.
Yeah, the two maps are shrink-wrapped.
Worth the price of admission alone just for the maps. So.
Yeah. But no, that's a great question. That's the idea.
And it's amazing to see them so clean today, looking new. For me, it is, anyway.
I should give a shout out to Steve Crompton, who's the guy doing the scanning. Steve's also the guy who created Grimtooth of Grimtooth's Traps. And he's like an incredible Photoshop digital whiz, and he's done an incredible job of. It's actually cool when.
Yeah, I want to thank him for that. He's done a great job.
He has done a great job. But when he started this project, he actually used to work at the Flying Buffalo store. In the 80s, and he was all excited because he used to sell these products back in the store, and he was excited to work on it.
We sold a lot of his stuff, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Rick was in all the time.
That's hilarious. Cool. Anyway, it's a lot of fun, and it'll be probably the end of the year by the time this comes out, because it turned out to be a lot more work than I thought, but but it's good.
So now we have two of these now. Is that it? Are we done?
That ambassador will come up.
Oh, we do. We have Bad Ambassador. That's Gen Con, right?
That'll be Gen Con.
Okay, yeah. So we'll have a third one at Gen Con release of Thieves of Fortress Bad Ambassador, which again the same thing. As we're giving the exceptional treatment with my kind of somewhat questionable material shoved in the back, but that's it. But
were these all written by your dad?
A large part of it was one of my dad's. Contributing authors at the time was Mark Summerlot. They worked very closely together. He's my uncle, as a matter of fact. He married my dad's sister. So they worked very closely.
And there's a huge body of work for Judges Guild, right? Like 150 to 200 releases or so?
Let's look at the booty list.
When my father passed, there was something like 214 titles.
Okay. And so there's a lot to choose from when deciding what to put in these volumes. And this is, it's not chronological or anything. This is based on stuff that Bob Bledsaw was heavily involved in. There's a lot of other favorite titles out there, and I'm sure if this does well, we'll eventually work our way towards, Invincible Lord and all the other awesome stuff. We'll work our way there.
All right.
Yeah. Any other questions? Those are great questions. All right. It's a lot of fun working on this, and it's a lot of fun hanging out with Bob and hearing his stories. And it's normal to you, but we didn't grow up in these families, so
yes.
Yeah, it's cool.
Glad to be here.
Cool. Glad to have you. So now let's see, just a couple other things we're working on. I have over there the cover art for Monster Alphabet Leather Edition. So I'm mostly just showing that off. So we had the Kickstarter for the Monster Alphabet, and we showed off the cover art for the normal edition and then the gold foil edition. And this is now ready to go to the printer. It's actually going on Monday. And this is the final piece that Stephen Pope just turned in. And I just think it's freaking awesome. It's only here because I got it a couple days ago and was blown away. And I feel like I need to turn it into a t-shirt or something. It's amazing. Yeah. But anyway, the leather edition's the really expensive one that not that many people bought. So maybe I'll try to work this into like an interior image on the other one or something. It turned out really good.
You didn't turn my alphabet into a t-shirt.
That's true. Don't take offense.
All right.
Vanna, do you mind flipping to the next image?
Vanna.
Yeah. And so behind that, some of you may have seen this, but this is the artist sketch edition cover of Frozen in Time. So Doug Kovacs is an amazing artist and does these beautiful color paintings that we all love and enjoy. And then before he gets to the color, he often does these sketches, which are often at the same quality as published work by other publishers and other artists. So as these modules sell out, you guys saw, starting with GaryCon, we're going to reprint sort of alternate covers that have some of the original sketches that Doug did. So this one's awesome. So that one's at the booth right now. It's, you know, produced especially for North Texas. Actually has the North Texas logo on the back. So pick one up while they're still around. But it looks awesome. Doug's actually in the back. Doug, would you like to comment on this picture? Anyway, it turned out
these
great.
These have the extra content that the digest size had?
Yes, good reminder. Yeah, so there's four extra pages that Mike wrote.
Yes, yes, and this is, so we've included this in here because we're all getting older. We've decided to take pity on those of us with aging eyes, and we've actually have a large scale one that you can read.
Increase the font size.
Yes. which that was kind of we were hoping to do that eventually anyway. So yeah. No. But yeah, it always I love the fact we've got now the full scale map of the Forlorn North and everything like this. So check it out.
And honestly, this whole process is inspired by Judges Guild, right? I mean, the first printings are selling out, so we're doing second and third printings. And just as Judges Guild did with Bat of Asgore, you know, a lot of companies reprint is kind of the same thing, but I think it's really cool to go back to the author and say, what's the thing you wanted to include,
yeah.
Right? People love this module, they bought them all, mm-hmm. and Mike had stuff you wanted to include, and then go back to the artist and say, you know, if you could tweak something or do something different, what would you want to show people? And yeah. That's how we get these.
Yeah, the problem with this is, like, we have a certain word count, we really can't, you know, after you know, we reach a point, you know, we have to start begging for Joseph, can I have, like, 1,000 more words? And then, of course, that starts making things bigger, and he says no. So, because he's still trying to, you know, sell this for somewhat reasonable and make a profit. So when you have to come back and do that and say, can I have 4 more pages? They're like, oh, can you have 4 more pages? You know? I give you 8. No, stop.
I don't want another Castle White Rock.
Oh, wait, we didn't tell you?
So then if you don't mind, Edgar, do you mind flipping the next one? It's now, let's talk a little bit about Lankmar. So this is the cover of the next installment in the Lankmar plan. And obviously this is licensed from the estate of Fritz Leiber. And the plan here is to eventually produce a large, robust box set that'll come out probably late this year, early next year, a very complete product. To work our way there and to show you guys what we're working on, we've done a couple, I'll call preview products. So GaryCon we showed through Nindobble's Cave. And of course, if you're a fan of the series, you know Nindobble. And this one is called the Patrons of Lankmar.
Patrons of Lankmar.
And it has rules for, why don't you tell them about it, Mike? Patron stats for a whole lot of...
Yes. We have 6 of some of the... There's a lot of supernatural entities in Leiber's work in the Fafnir Great Master stories. So we picked 6 of them, which were kind of emblematic of the series. Anything from, you know, the low-level kind of archmage type stuff to kind of the death himself. So we put together 6 of these, and this just to kind of give you a taste of what we have in store for the Lankmar box set, but it's also something that you can use in your DCC game as it is. I mean, I've already heard reports that people have started to integrate these. I heard Nindobble is being used in somebody's campaign. They were asking me for information about that. Mm-hmm. The rat god showed up, right? Yep. So just recently, also the rat god showed up. Hey, look, is somebody coming to join us? No. All right, so we've got things going on with that. So this introduces, we've got a half dozen in here, everything except, unfortunately, for the patron spells, because every patron spell is 3 pages, so we can either give you 6 cool patrons or 3 full ones. So we decided that quantity over quality at this point. But when the box set comes out, you know, we'll have the information on that. We'll have the patron spells and everything. But this is kind of, for, you know, for those of you looking to introduce Lankmar stuff now, or just to kind of give a taste of what we have in store for you guys, you know, come here, check it out. This may or may not be reprinted at some point, so if you're a collector, you know, I pick it up now.
The content will be in the box set, but this right. actual printing is going to be, it's more of a preview
yeah.
item.
It's easy to drop into your campaign.
Right.
Yeah.
People have asked if the box set is just going to be like these collected, and no, it's not. So.
It's going to be big. So now I'm going to talk through a couple other things going on in the world of DCC, and then eventually Edgar will tell you about his adventures. So, don't flip that one yet. That's a secret. Let me tell about a couple other things first. So this is the actual judges screen that we've been talking about for like 2 years now. So this will be available for free on Free RPG Day. Doug did 3 awesome panels for it, and pick it up on June 20th at your local game store or visit freerpgday.com. Anyway, it turned out great. And actually, it's funny. We spent all this time selecting what tables to include, and then one of the guys in the forums put together his own GM screen. With an awesome selection of tables, I'm like, God, I wish I'd included those. Like, yes. So I guess there's room to eventually do another one with a couple more tables, because we did kind of use up all the space, but he had some great ideas for what to include, too. Anyway, it turned out great. Doug did a great job of the paintings. And something we'll have on the website in a couple weeks is we're still planning to do some sort of adventure module writing contest. So the idea is that, you know, a lot of A lot of game products, the content comes first and then the art comes after. This is one of the cases where the art came first, but there's like a story in every panel here. And some of that story is in Doug's head. But some of that story can be shared with everybody through your own heads. So the contest will basically consist of, inspired by this art, send us a pitch on what kind of adventure you want to write around it. And there'll be details on the website in the next couple weeks. So pick up a copy, or of course you can see the images online. And we'll finally have a GM screen using the games. So then also for Free RPG Day, not that you guys play 5th edition, but there will be a 5th edition product for those of you who are interested. But it's fine, we can stay in the 70s, so I'll not hide this now.
Is that the one that was part of the Kickstarter
threshold? Yeah, exactly. And I'm actually very happy the 5th edition is being so well received. Because that's what you need for the next generation, is something sort of modern to pull them in, and people like this edition. It seems to be everybody's second favorite edition, which is great. Everybody loves their first or their third or whatever, and then they like this second most, which is great. So it's come along well. It's good. And then, Edgar, do you mind telling them about your new adventure? So Edgar Johnson here has done some work for us before, but recently did a great job on probably the most sci-fi-ish of all the sci-fi modules we've done.
Yeah. You know,
science fantasy, I guess you'd say?
Yeah, it's science fantasy. Been trying to get Joseph to let me publish something for a while, and then he gave me a little bit in the back of the Bride of the Black Mance, and I guess it was about 3 months later, you said, hey, here's a list of things, which one would you want to do? And I said Howard, and somebody else got Howard, and then he says, all right, I want you to do something with Fred Saberhagen, Sterling Lanier, Margaret St. Clair, Edgar Rice Burroughs' Venus novels, and a couple other things he threw in there. And so I started doing my homework, and I ended up having a hard time writing this because I was trying to get a story on the paper before I knew who was going to be in the story. And I inflicted that on Doug and James, McGeorge, and a couple other people. I was trying to write it as I was playtesting it, right? And it went horribly, and Doug had a conversation with me afterwards. He says, I was bored, and we sort of talked about ways to make something as sprawling as this work a little bit better, and I don't know who came up with it. It might have been him.
Wayne gets credit.
Wayne came up with the idea of, I'll get to it in a minute. There's a plot device in there that helps you take this thing and kind of rein it in. What we're dealing with is a post-apocalyptic landscape. This dead city that people have been fighting over for centuries, and there's four factions that are kind of vying for control of this place. And the PCs are recruited through a patron, and you can sort of figure out who that patron is, how they get there, whatever, but they're there to do a job. They're there to take out the Overlord, and the Overlord is this cybernetic being who lives in this gigantic mobile, you know, fortress tank thing, and they need to locate a device, transport it across the landscape, get it there, and do some things with it that may make bad things happen, may make good things happen. Your players will probably think it's one kind of device. It's not that kind of device. I totally used Fred Saberhagen's kind of take on what a device of this kind can possibly do, right? I'm very thankful to Joseph to giving me as much leeway as he did in terms of word count. I was talking to Brendan LaSalle. I was talking to Brendan LaSalle at Coast College, and he said, well, how long did it run? I said, it was almost 17,000 words. He's like, he gave you 17,000 words? And I was like, yeah. He's like, you're so lucky. So I feel very
lucky. I didn't hear that.
That was the case. And I think it might be a case of me overwriting the damn thing rather than Joseph giving me a whole lot of leeway. And him saying, okay, we're going to have to make this work. I'll give the kid, you know, 17,000 words. But it's a whole city. And obviously I can't give you everything that's in there, but what I've tried to give you is a sense of who the factions are, what motivates them, how they relate to each other, some tables to kind of fill in the details, an internal logic for the undercity, the city above, and a few other little trinkets in there. There are usable grappling rules, for example, if you want to use them.
Let's see the art.
Oh, yeah,
show product.
Here,
all right. Yeah. So,
what can you say the name yet, either?
Dungeon Crawl Classics number 87 against the Atomic Overlord.
Yeah.
So, and let me tell them about the covers, then I'll give it back to you.
Sure.
But so, because I'm addicted to this stuff, we have Doug's awesome art, we have Doug's sketch art. Now, when I got the interior art that Doug did, there's this amazing image that was going to be used for the interior. We have every DCC module has what I call the band image, so the members of the band are always in one interior image, usually the centerfold. But this image, I saw it, I was like, that's like an album cover, like this should be an album cover. Anyway, so that's the album cover edition. We just did a couple copies, and it's got pictures of the contributors on the back and the North Texas logo. Again, we just did a short run of this, but just because it's really cool. And I actually looked into printing it. I don't know if I told you this. I tried to find a printer who could actually do like an like slip sleeve album cover, but it's apparently not common and very expensive. So we just went with the book. But yeah, it's a really cool concept. So yeah, tell us more.
Well, I've tried to run it at one con, and just because of the way the games were scheduled, I had pretty low attendance, was not able to run it. But I ran it yesterday. We got a couple people who were here that were in that game. How'd it go?
It was great. It was amazing. I can't wait to run him through it.
So it's got good customer reviews so far. And John Hirschberger says it's moving briskly at the booth.
That's great.
So I'm really happy with it and really looking forward to another chance to write something for Goodman Games.
So one of the things I like about this that you did a really good job with was people think of D&D as being fantasy, right? And the modern day fantasy means, you know, Tolkien and Robert E. Howard, and those guys are all great. But the addition of D&D that happened back in the 70s was inspired by science fiction as much as fantasy. And Bob was even talking about this morning. And there's a lot of these authors in Appendix N that are overlooked nowadays, but like Fred Saberhagen, who was basically a sci-fi author, you know?
My dad was a big fan of Robert Heinlein.
Oh, really? Okay. Right. Yeah. And that comes out in a lot of the products. And so people look at this cover with a giant tank, what appear to be airplanes, you know, a monorail system, and they might think that's not fantasy at all. But everything in here was inspired by four Appendix N authors who were on Gary Gygax's list of inspiration from the 70s. And you did a great job of capturing that sort of other side of fantasy.
I guess I should talk about the monorail just briefly. That was the device, the device that we used as a plot device, because you have a whole city. How do you keep your players on track without railroading them? Well,
the monorail. Technically, your monorail.
It's a monorail, right? And it can be used for more than just getting from the place where they start to the place where they're going to end up. But it gives the judge a very easy way to make that happen and to have some interesting things happen along the way that will make it a little bit more difficult to get from, you know, point A to point B. And I think that really, I was very anxious when I was trying to figure out how to make this work. And just having that and just sort of embracing the railroad helped me get to a point where I'm just like, okay, now I know how to relax about this and really make it work. And I can concentrate on the factions that are involved and what they're really like and why we would want to root for one or the other or you know, things of that nature, which when we're writing good stories, honestly, you gotta worry about those characters first, right? Not just the PCs, but NPCs that you actually give a damn about, right? So that really helped me out.
It turned out great. So let me show you guys a couple other things for DCC. I'll show off this cover art that Mr. Doug Kovacs did. So Joe Bittman did a great piece inspired by Jack Vance, which is called the 998 Conclave of Wizards. Anyway, this is how things get out of control. Doug read the manuscript, he's like, that's awesome. And I was like, you want to draw a bunch of wizards? He's like, yeah. And somehow we ended up saying, let's do a two-page painting. So it's a front and back cover. Anyway, here we have the result. And I think we had the sketch of this at GaryCon. I don't know if you guys can see this. You're welcome to come up afterwards. But, you know, artists, I'm going to... So Doug doesn't want to talk, so I'm just going to say a bunch of things and rile him up so he's eventually going to speak. So artists often...
Keep talking.
All right.
Can we get it?
Yeah.
So artists keep drawing lots and lots of people faces, right? It's easy to draw a couple monsters. You can't get a monster wrong. But drawing a lot of individual creatures is a lot of work. Drawing a lot of individual people who have to look like people can be a lot of work. The fact that Doug actually got this inspired by this image and actually volunteered to essentially paint a ton of cool-looking wizards is awesome. So this module is about going to speak on behalf of Joe, but it's a really cool adventure where the players essentially go to an asteroid floating through space where this cabal of lizards has built their secret headquarters. And once every, you know, 1,000 years or something, they have
conclave. 900 every 1,000 years. 998th conclave. I just read it.
Okay. But this is, there's an important event that will happen at the, I guess, the 1,000th conclave.
Right.
This is the
998th. We got 2 years to get there.
Yeah, exactly. And special things have to happen before that event occurs. And so the players get tied up in this situation where they have to help out this cabal of lizards. But the module is awesome because it's not just, you know, your typical exploration, but it really is a cabal of all these interesting, unique wizard characters. So you can use this almost as like a, if you need a wizard NPC, you can then take this art and point to one of the images and say, hey, you know, this is the guy you're meeting. Half these guys are inspired directly by Job's writing, and the other half are Doug coming up with cool ideas for wizards. Anyway, so it turned out great. We're going to try to get this out by Gen Con. We've got a lot of work to do still to finish up the maps and other stuff, but hopefully it'll be out by Gen Con. So good job, Doug. It's turned out great.
Thank you.
And then let me show you one other thing Doug's working on. And this is very much in the sketch phase. Are you okay with me showing this?
What is it?
The Dread God sketch? The
color. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So that is back here. So the Dread God of Alcazadar is something that Daniel Bishop wrote. We talked about it for a while, but haven't actually. This is a very rough.
Daniel Bishop, who has written a lot of third party stuff at this point.
Quite a bit. And written the free RPGA module from 2 years ago, I think it was. Another short adventure that will come out at Gen Con.
Which one was that?
The
you go to a mountain and there's weird prehistoric fish ghosts in there.
That's the one, actually, yeah.
I can't remember what it's called.
There you go, yeah.
He wrote on Purple Planet, too.
Yep, on Purple Planet, too. He's done a lot of great stuff. Anyway, so this is the cover for his first DCC module, which, Doug, do you want to explain it?
Okay, so it's called the Dread God something, Alcazar. So his description of the Dread God Alcazar is just a silhouette in the sky over Punjar. And I think if I did anything in this stupid, ugly painting, you can all see that, at least, from yes. Back here. I can see it. And then I just started reading through his module, and Joe, you probably don't remember, but like 2 years ago when we were first talking about putting this out, all the writers sent me descriptions of ideas for covers, and then of course I said something bad in exchange and ignored. Mike, you weren't part of this because you know better. You don't know better. So anyway, I went back in. I was like going to be like, Joe, what should we put on the cover? And rather than waiting for Joe to get back to me, I just spent the time looking through emails to find what was originally said. And I found Daniel Bishop's descriptions, and they were cool. But then I just read through the adventure, and every cool image I came to, I had the my laptop here, and I had the easel here, and every cool image I came to, I put it into the painting, and then painted something out, put something else over it, you know. But there's a crocodile crossed with a centipede, which if that's not a cool fucking idea, I don't know what is. So I put that in there, and then there's red, red people. They're like Martian something or others. I'm not, I gotta read. I gave him a gun. I'm not sure whether he should have a gun. I'm not sure whether he should have a gun or not. And the new Crossing New Grounds, first time you guys hear it here, Joe is gonna put a naked old woman on the cover. It's very progressive of Joe to allow that to happen, and it's actually really cool that he's so open-minded. He lives close to San Francisco, so he thinks like this, you know.
He even says that in the margin. Doug knows, naked old woman.
Does it?
I don't think
Oh, yeah, that's it. And it's spelled wrong, I think. It says make. What does that say?
Yeah, it's got a D. O-L-O-D.
Oh, okay. don't look at the writing.
So it must be true.
It says some other stuff here, too. Ella, because I couldn't spell alligator. Ella centipede. I couldn't spell centipede. And then it says prince and princess. Okay, so the red people are prince and princess, which is cool.
Ladies and gentlemen, the artistic process.
Anyway, this is the rough sketch. It'll end up looking just cool by the time it's done. But it's looking great.
This time next year, that'll be the first printing cover.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And the other thing that I'll point out about these is if you notice the last couple of covers, Doug did dominant red color theme.
Right.
If you look at Purple Planet, dominant red color theme. If you look at Hole in the Sky, which I don't have here, dominant red color
it's
theme.
More orange or pink, but maybe you can't see colors. That's good.
So our key artistic criteria right now is not so much red.
The color scheme for this one is no red.
Right. Working out pretty good. No red.
Right. There's red in this one. This one
like
red and green, right?
Yeah.
We can go back to red now.
Okay. Yeah. So cool. Thanks, Doug. So that's our progress. We'll be coming out soon. Last couple things on DCC. For those of you who are first edition fans, we actually did a first edition conversion for Gen Con 2007, which is a long time ago. This is Harley Stroh's Witch Queen saga. So Legacy of the Savage Queen, Legacy of the Savage Kings, and then he did a sequel called Saga of the Witch Queen. Anyway, and then John Hershberger wrote sort of a bridging adventure between the two of them, and we released them a long time ago, Gen Con 2007, which seems fresh in my mind, but it was a long time ago. So for this con, we did a special reprint of this one. Since this is kind of an old school con, a 1E module seemed appropriate, so we'll have some of these in the booth too. And they have the North Texas store on the back too, so all supplies last. And the last couple of DCC things, we have some DCC stuff at the booth. At long last, we got the sweatshirt, just in time for your 90 degree weather in Texas. It's really hot here. When I got off the plane last night, I was like, wow. And we got the, thank you. And a couple other options here. We got the Texas orange and the military green. I'll show you the other ones later.
Okay.
Right off of, but pick those up. And then the last thing on DCC, Mr. Jim Lampler here is the head of the Secret Cabal and has been working on the latest tournament adventure and a lot of projects he's working on here to run that adventure. But anyway, if you don't mind, Ed, here, flip to the next one. And Jim, tell them about Death by Nexus and what you're working on with that.
That's the second Rogue Crew Level Zero tournament funnel, and I'm not just working on it. Everybody who played this weekend worked on it very collaboratively because I learned a lesson that it's very important to play test these things at cons and at home, but not in that order. It needs to be at home first. So thank you to everybody who played this weekend and contributed to us. Last night ran much better. We were able to address some of the issues that came up in it. But it's really exciting. The Dungeon Crawl Cabal is this particular adventure is written by myself, Stephen Newton, Daniel J. Bishop, Jeffrey Tadlock, John Marr, and Bob Brinkman, who's going to be doing some writing for Goodman, starting with this and some other stuff coming down the road. And it's very exciting because we're kind of blazing trails. We're not the only ones doing it. Dave Beatty's doing it with the Carnival Clowns, and Hardy's working on some stuff too. But it's like a new art form. It's a new kind of character funnel. And Hardy's the guy who invented the basic premise of how can you run a DCC tournament with the swingy system. Let's do a character funnel where it's scored by how many encounters you survive. And so the Cabal, we're experimenting with the format. The Hypercube of Might was your classic tomb-like death trap to try and survive. And Death by Nexus is interdimensional gladiatorial battle where the players are divided up into alignment teams. And that was very interesting how that played this weekend because there were times when chaos and neutrality just decided law had to go.
Often.
And chaos got beat up on a lot. They kind of got ganged up on a bunch, too. The premise of it is that they're above the DCC patrons and deities. There's these multiversal entities called the Prime Ones that don't understand alignments. To them, it's a quaint ideological construct. So they have tasked the DCC patrons to gather up a bunch of level zero peasants and, like the old Star Trek episode, Gamesters of Triskelion, duke it out in various different scenarios armed with various different devices, weapons, and sometimes transformations. We conducted Ragnarok last night, which was quite exciting.
That's awesome.
So a level zero DCC tournament in which gods died last night. Gods got taken out. And that's about as old school as I can think of.
That's pretty cool. So this one will be, once we finish the playtesting and work out all the details, this will be free to road crew members.
Yeah, it should be by time for Gen Con.
So. Yeah, cool.
The new and improved version of this will be run at Gen Con. And I want to mention that because Doug can't do every single thing. it's this great cover art by James V. West, who also did the cover art for the Hypercube Mic.
And it's great, because it gives a chance for DCC players to run this at their local store, for their local group, whatever, for free. And Jim's does an amazing job of corralling a bunch of creative minds and producing a great product.
Thank you.
Really good job. Now, do you have that hat, Mike?
Yes, I do. As everybody may or may not know, we decided we were going to have, since speaking of Gen Con, we had the Lankmar Trivia Contest, where I was going to run a special, as kind of the anti-DugCon, rather, where everything is crazy and everything like that. I was going to take a small select group of people and take them to a secret location and run a special DCC Lankmar game for them. So I challenged them with 10 frustrating questions, and out of all the contestants, only 4 answered 10 out of 10 correctly. So I would like to announce those 4 winners right now. So these people, assuming that they make it to Gen Con, the winners of the 4 out of the 6 seats are going to be Peter Smits, Matthew Miranda, Jim McLaughlin, and Marv Breed. So, gentlemen, if you're out there, congratulations.
And just to be clear, Mike has reread the entire Fritz Leiber Lankmar works twice now, I think.
Yep.
Wow.
And so these trivia questions were not easy. The first couple ones you can get, by the time you get to number 10, you really need to reread them all twice to get this. So the fact that 4 people even got all 10 right is pretty impressive.
Very good. So after that, since we didn't fill all 6 seats, we had 4 contestants who answered 9 out of 10 correctly. So what we're going to do, since we have 2 seats over, we're going to have a random drawing from this very Lankmar hat to fill those 2 seats. And then the other two people who got 9 out of 10 will be our alternates should something occur. I'm not advocating assassination or anything, but should anything occur to the winners and we have to fill those seats. So Mark, you're right here, and since we're going to do this completely above board, and we can't have it, so would you draw a name from the hat, please, and make sure that one name. Drop it on the floor, please. All right, so the filling in seat number feet, number 5 will be, oh crap. Jim Sketch. Let me make a note of that so I don't forget. Like, he won't remind me.
It's on video, dude.
Jim Sketch. All right, so the sitting in on the 6th seat will be Kerry Olson. So I will see you two gentlemen at Gen Con. And should anything happen to either is cool, I noticed.
You remember that name, huh?
Yeah. Our two runners up are Bob Brinkman. Luke Enyart. I believe that is correct. I hope it's correct. Right. Luke Enyart. So gentlemen, if anything happens to those 6, I'll see you guys. All right, so there we go. Business taken care of.
Thanks, Mike.
And I was not responsible for getting this hang, so.
All right, so just a couple more things to talk about. As you guys know, I've been working with Jim Ward on Metamorphosis Alpha, and the first project we did last year was to reprint the original work and then all the stuff that was in Dragon's Dungeon and then some add-on stuff. If you don't mind, flipping the next one up here. So this is the cover to Epsilon City, which we discussed at GaryCon. And the Kickstarter for this will actually launch in about a week, so we're about a week away from launching it. And I want to just talk to you a little bit about some of the stuff that's going to go into it, so it's pretty cool. Jim, of course, has had this vision for Epsilon City for, I don't know, how many years, probably close to 40. And it's kind of the major metropolis on the Starship Orton. And he has all these ideas for sort of themed encounters there, like the Wolfoids that dress like pirates,
yep,
and sort of an Egyptian-themed area and so on. So it's kind of just a wildly imaginative section of the Starship and a crazy city to go with it. But among other things, he wants to introduce new colored armbands. So for the first time in a long time, Metamorphosis Alpha will get new colored armbands. And then in addition to that, there are a lot of folks who wound up trying to collect the armbands from the first Kickstarter, so he wants to do it. He wants to do another run of those, so we're actually going to offer those as an add-on, so if you're missing them, whatever. But he insists on not printing any more of the captain's bands. So the other 5 will be produced. Yeah, but if you have a captain's band, you're one of the few people to get one. So it's pretty cool.
Thanks for breaking the bad news to me in public.
Then I also have a cyborg character class for the first time, introducing a new option for players from Metamorphosis Alpha, and Jim's doing a lot of work on that, and it turned out pretty cool. But I wanted to tell you one more thing that we haven't talked about yet. Jim had an idea for binding. So Metamorphosis Alpha, the hardcover we did, is really a collector's volume. Like, obviously, it's a huge book. And a lot of people, it turns out, wanted to play the game, right? Which is cool. There's a lot of people actively using that at the table. So we've had requests to reprint that volume in a more user-friendly tabletop format. And as part of that conversation, Jim reminded me of something he worked on several years ago. But it's this kind of spiral-bound binding for a hardcover, which is quite cool because it's a hardcover, but it lies perfectly flat. So we're actually going to do Epsilon City using this kind of binding. I found a printer that can do it, and it totally works out perfectly. So Epsilon will be a very table-friendly game. And then depending on the interest in the Kickstarter, there's some folks who... Kickstarter's great because you can test an idea. There's a lot of people who keep asking me to reprint that giant hardcover in a tabletop-friendly format, so if there's enough interest, we'll probably do a version of it like this too, so you can actually play at the table. And then there's some folks who are going to help on this project. Mike and Jim, as well as Joe Bittman and John Hook, are all going to be involved in helping Jim sort of flesh out a lot of the content and expand Epsilon City.
Yeah, we get to play around in Epsilon City, and the ideas that have been going around are already interesting, but we'll keep those secret for now. But
okay. Anyway, so look for the Kickstarter in about a week. It'll be awesome. And the last thing, as long as we're talking about dungeons, and as long as we're talking about meetings, some of you may know the worst kept secret in dungeon culture, which is that Jim Rampler here has been working on something for 2 years or so now. And actively playtesting at cons for over a year now, it seems like. Something called You Can Crawl Classics. So if you don't mind flipping the image, we're going to finally announce this for publication. Jim, tell us about You Can Crawl Classics.
The thing with You Can Crawl Classics is based on what I think, and even Jim Ward says this is crazy if I say this in public, I think the second greatest RPG ever written is Gammaworld. Because every game that came after D&D was either structured as a reference to Dungeons & Dragons or different from. And the thing that's beautiful about the original Gammaworld is its task was just to be science fiction D&D. So the character classes, the game mechanics, and the structure are identical to D&D. And when Joseph came out with Dungeon Crawl Classics, I saw a chance to kind of give that post-apocalyptic genre its due and do something that at one point Gary Gygax actually intended to do and never got around to. Gary wanted to create a universal rule system that blended D&D and Gammaworld and all the various systems TSR was publishing at one time. So what I've done with Mutant Crawl Classics is do a post-apocalyptic version of Dungeon Crawl Classics that's 100% seamlessly compatible. The two go together so well that you can just drop characters and monsters back and forth. There's a very near equivalent in Mutant Crawl Classics to everything you like in DCC. And just like DCC, it's heavily inspired by the primary sources, the appendix and the literature. So the authors that influence Mutant Crawl Classics, it's like Jack Vance, Brian Aldiss, a lot of Jim Ward, with little Jack Kirby in it. If anybody remembers Commandy, Last Boy on Earth. I can't help, that's my friend.
You bring that up every chance you get.
I know. So mutations, the mechanics work exactly like spell checks do in DCC. There are patrons. There are global and sometimes extraterrestrial artificial intelligences. And the thing about Mutant Crawl Classics is it's Vancian science. That's my new term for the super science that's in there. So you're not going to stumble across a tank or an AK-47. It's all the apocalypse that happened is ambiguous, but there's a red bloated sun, there's no moon, there's a sky arc in the sky, as you can see that it's painted. Hothouse jungles, the player characters are tribal, Neolithic level guys who are just trying to go out and dig up. I mean, the expected tropes are all in there. There's power armor, there's particle weapons, but there's a lot more in MCC that's designed to mimic DCC's mystery and suspense. So it's everything you remember and love about the post-apocalypse, but like a lot of new stuff. The AIs grant shamans in MCC wetware programs. And to paraphrase Jack Vance, the wetware programs are just the extra-dimensional artificial intelligence impregnating your brain, the quantum laws, motions, and verbal components to change the laws of physics. In other words, they're spells. Word programs are spells and operate exactly that same way.
That's awesome. And it's entirely backwards compatible, as you mentioned.
Yes.
So you can take your DCC guys, port them over to Lankmar, then flip them back and port them over to DCC.
Yeah. Have to stop by the Purple Planet, you know, get some moonshine in the Shutter Mountains.
I mean, adventures like Edgar wrote, you could play in both systems easily on the fly with no changes. And in the playtesting, we took Intrigue at the Court of Chaos, Up Caro's Gambit, and some of those things, and with very light reskinning that I virtually did on the fly, ran them in the MCC system flawlessly.
There's an outcome in this that would almost require that you pick up a copy of
all part of the Sinister Master Plan.
Yes. And to stick with the theme of word count, I think when Joseph and I were discussing this for the first time over dinner, it was 30 or 40,000 words we were looking at.
You ended up at 80, am I remembering?
87. as we went back and forth.
But it's good content, right? As I get the manuscripts, I'm like, wow, this is pretty good. Okay, keep going.
Full patron write-ups.
Yeah.
You wanted androids?
Yes, there's androids. There's lots of great, it's great. Like when you read it, it'll sort of blow your mind the way other stuff blows your mind. You think, I want to play this right now, you know?
Other dinosaurs?
I don't remember any dinosaurs.
There's another 5,000 words, Jim.
That's the other DCC dinosaur.
Hang on.
Coming soon.
There's a monster called the Sea Rex that's basically a tyrannosaur-shaped sentient cactus.
You can't have those 5,000 words anymore.
So, Joseph, now you can reskin your original game for DCC. Well,
is it backwards compatible with dinosaurs?
So it'll be coming out probably into this year. The manuscript's completely done, which is always the first step in this project. But Jim turned in a great manuscript that's totally done, that's in editing now. And at Gen Con, our goal is to have in the Gen Con program guide a short preview of just some of the key parts of the manuscript, so you guys can see what's coming. But it turned out great.
So what's the format of it? Is it a book?
Good question. It'll be a hardcover book. It'll be the second ever hardcover for DCC. But it's, you know, 87,000 words, there's enough material there.
I want to talk a little bit about the art Doug did, because I actually commissioned the art to help inspire me to write it. So the art came in front of a lot of the writing, and this is a pencil sketch. There's the painting. Doug did a fantastic job of capturing this far future look that's sort of retro at the same time, like you'd expect in Jack Vance. Because I am who I am, I'm like, give me one each of the genotypes, but no white male protagonist. So female character there, some mutant bug guy, a plant in it, and a robot that's murderous, as they all are.
Maybe he's just trying to hug.
Is that what it is? And the last thing is, we have a couple items for Metamorphs and Sophon here, if you don't mind. Grab that. If you didn't already get a chance, we have a similar shirt to what was released in, this is a Jim Ward story. So I did this shirt for Gary Kahn in two color schemes. And after they were all printed, Jim's like, can I get that in green? Anyway, so here's the green edition for Jim Ward. And then this is an awesome idea by Lester Portley, who does a lot of the graphic design for these things. And he's a huge fan of Metamorphosis Alpha and Judge's Guild and all this other stuff. But he had the idea to do an authentic, if you're on the Warden, what's the shirt you would wear? So turned out really
that's cool. My favorite shirt so far. I've
I know. And it's
I cool. Love wearing that yesterday. So.
It's nice and subtle, too. And then also, if you buy enough stuff, you get a free bag. It's a cool idea.
Do you want to talk the Gen Con Programs Guild before we wrap things up?
Sure. We're running out of time, but just a quick overview. So Gen Con every year, we do what I call the Gen Con Program Guide, which is really an excuse to just throw a bunch of cool stuff together. And it's the kind of short articles and short works and things that don't have a natural place, or when writers write too much and there's some great content that we want to throw together. So we're going to have that at Gen Con this year. The first year was mostly sort of interviews and reprints and previews. The second year had a fair amount of new content. This will be the biggest ever. It'll be 160 pages of all new content. It's got several new short DCC modules. It'll include the Hyperkiba Might in print as well. It'll have the preview of MCC RPG.
Starter rules for MCC.
Yep. It actually has new Metamorphosis Alpha content. So some of the material that was produced for the Kickstarter didn't find its right place. It was a couple articles for Metamorphosis Alpha. It has some fiction for X-Crawl as well as the first piece of DCC fiction by Brennan LaSalle. It has a preview of the X-Crawl DCC material that Brennan's working on, one of the new classes. And actually, I was going to include, Bob, among the many things we unearthed in the Judges Guild projects were some of the original catalogs that Judges Guild produced back when they were essentially a retailer and distributor back in the 70s. So it has a scan of the 1977 Judges Guild catalog, which is awesome because there's a little bit of content in there, and as you go through it, it's all this cool product you can buy back in the 70s. And a bunch of other articles that aren't even coming to me right now. There's a couple dice-related articles. Gary Gygax wrote a great article in the AD&D Dungeon Master's Guide about dice probabilities. This might have been the player's guide, actually.
No, it's a DMG. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, it's got a bell curve graph and everything.
Yeah, exactly. So we decided, why not do that with the D7 and the D5? So Terry Olson did a great, he's an engineer by trade and is really good at math. So it's this whole probability article, and if you use like D7s for character generation, and there's all sorts of cool tables and graphs. It's actually really cool. It came out great. And Ken St. Andre did a 20 funky dice tables, just random tables that use funky dice. Anyway, the program guide will be great this year. It's a lot of really cool content with all sorts of, just fun stuff inside. So that'll be on sale at Gen Con. Anything else I forgot about?
What's that? Because I didn't hear anything. You say anything? That alphabet?
Oh, that's right.
I'm keyed into alphabet, so I...
Yes, you guys know about the dungeon alphabet and the monster alphabet. One of the ideas they came up with was to do a Cthulhu alphabet, or the Mythos alphabet, whatever you want to call it. D is for deep ones, T is for tentacles.
That's awesome.
Stuff like that. So within the program guide, doing a whole book is a big deal, but Brad McDevitt, some of you may know, is an artist who works on a lot of products I do, and he's also he's a really creative guy. He's also a writer, which most people don't realize. He's written several games as well. He's the kind of guy who can just do all aspects of a project. So he's done just a couple letters. D is for deep ones, T is for tentacles, W is for worshippers, and I think it was C is for cultists, if I remember correctly.
Sounds like it could be right.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Certainly sounds appropriate.
So I'm excited to hear about it, That's why I'm hoping you talk about it.
Anything else in my notes you want to review?
I don't know.
Anyway, that'll be in the program guide as well. It's just a sort of a preview of the concept, but if you guys like the concept and it's popular, we can expand that. Mike, what else should I go?
What's that?
In the Purple Planet Authors Edition, there was the glossographies, some of which have been sort of found and not all of them found. So Harley's including another glossography entry for the Purple Planet in the program guide.
I think I hit everything.
Did I cover everything? Okay, cool.
You didn't mention anything about Grimtooth. What's the status of Grimtooth?
Thanks, yeah.
You're welcome.
So Grimtooth is off to
the printer. I'll be building you after the convention.
Yeah, anyway, Grimtooth is off to the printer. We're going to have the soft cover available by Gen Con for Gen Con pickup, which is great. The hardcover has a lot of insertions and custom elements and gatefolds and fancy stuff that takes longer to print. So that one, of course, it won't take too long. But it's off to the printer, which is a good news. I think that's it. Any other questions from you guys before we wrap up? All right, thanks a lot, everybody.
Thanks.
It's been great. Thanks to Bob.
Crawl Classics out there.
Speaking of which, I'm late for a game.
Thanks, guys.